So we have reached the last leg of Kathopanishad. We are covering the sixth chapter, and we start from verse number 9. To remind you, Kathopanishad is being summed up. Whatever has been discussed earlier, the same thing is being told again, but in slightly different language. And that's the tradition of the Upanishads. At one place, Acharya Shankar beautifully says, Sastra namna jamita asti. The scriptures, they never tire of telling the correct thing repeatedly. Because they know that these sublime truths, they're so subtle that people cannot grasp them easily. Now forget about practicing them. You can't even grasp. So that's why same thing is told again, again and again. If you read any of the scriptures from any religion, you'll find that certain facts, certain fundamental spiritual facts are repeated, maybe not in the same words, slightly differently, but repetition will always be there. Whatever the spiritual text, because is the profundity of the subject, the sublime truths. Unless your mind becomes one with those truths, you cannot grasp. When you look at all the things that you have learned all your life, you will see that you have been evolving. And as you have been evolving, your understanding has been evolving. And as your understanding has been evolving, your tastes are changing. For example, when you were young, you might have loved fast music, film songs, rap, and things like that. Now, as you grow, your understanding changes, and you go more for classical things. You want for softer things, because your understanding is changing. And because your understanding is changing, your taste is changing. Try teaching the same thing to kids. They will take it as punishment. Something similar happens with the truths of Upanishads. Unless you mature spiritually and intellectually, you cannot grasp them. Until you can grasp them, you continue to love the popular sayings, popular words, popular stories, popular ideas. So, the Upanishads, they repeat themselves. But this repetition is not of words, but of ideas. Verse number 9 says, Na sandrisheti stati rupamasya, na chakshusa pashyati kashchanenam, hrida manisha mansa bhiklripto, ya etad vidur amritaste bhavanti. Says, you can't see Atman with your eyes because it is not an object. The discussion is on Atman. Says, it's not an object that you can see. And by the word seeing, it implies all the senses. This idea has been narrated earlier also. And na chakshusa na sandrise tishtati rupamasya na chakshusa pashyati kashchanenam. Hrida manisha mansa viklipto. It stays in the heart of hearts and it controls the mind. And that's why when you control your mind completely, you reach the stillness of mind. It is then that you realize Atman. The knowledge of Atman, it can neither be, you know, this idea keeps coming in the Upanishads. And it's not about Atman, it's about God. Whatever we are discussing about Atman, same thing is applicable to God too. You can never see God with your eyes, or you can know God through any of your senses. He resides inside you. So, you see God intuitively in the stillness of your mind. Till there is even the slightest movement of thought of any kind, you rest assured that you cannot know Atman, you cannot know God. If you really want to know God, first, your external organs need to be calmed, then senses need to be controlled, and finally, mental waves, the mind needs to be stilled. Only then you know. And once you know that, you become immortal, you become master of the universe. It's not that you don't gain anything, you gain. What do you gain? You become immortal. That means the subtle body that is there inside you, it doesn't have to pass through transmigration. You don't go on getting new births. You become one with the universal, you become one with the infinite. And how do you reach that state, says, Yada panchavatishthante jnanani mansasa buddhischana visheshtati tamahu paramam gatim. In yoga philosophy, it's mentioned how the state of calmness, the state of stillness is known as chitta vritti nirodh. Whenever there is some impulse from outside or some impulse from within, through memory, through dreams, etc., mind gets into agitation. Waves are formed, mental waves are formed. And because those mental waves are there, you cannot see God. Because the fundamental principle of knowing God is stillness of mind. If there is even one single thought, one single wave, you cannot know God. So he says, when all the five senses, that is eyes, ears, etc., they are resolved in their root cause, that is mind, and the mind is resolved in the Atman, whole thing is kind of pushed back. The expansion and the elaboration that has been with our body, the driving forces behind this body is pushed back. And finally, the intellect, even that does not move. We have earlier discussed this, but this, since the idea is being repeated, mind is when there is vacillation, when you do not know what's right, what is wrong. And intellect is when the mind is fixed. So if you say that, if you think that, I want to realize God, it's not mind working. Mind is a general term, but in Indian traditions, mind and intellect, these are differentiated. So if your intellect is firm that I want to know God, it's higher mind. If there is slightest movement, even of the higher mind, you cannot know God. It does not mean that you are running after the ordinary things. Your mind is thinking about ordinary things. If your mind is moving even at higher plane, that I want to know God, I want to know scriptures, I want to stay merged in the thought of God, your intellect is working. And if you think, oh, it has been such a long time, I have been practicing, when will I get the grace of God, when will I realize God, even then you are not going to get God. Your thoughts are noble, your thoughts are exalted, even then you are not going to get, simply because if there is slightest motion even of the intellect, God cannot be known. God can be known only in the stillness of mind. That stillness of mind is known as yoga. And this idea is explained in verse number 11. Tam yogam iti manyante sthiram indriya dharanam apramattas tadabhavati yogo hi pravapyo. This verse number 11, it's such a beautiful, actually Kathopanishad has very beautiful mantras. If you chance to read Patanjali's Yoga Sutras, it is all about yoga. And the idea of yoga, it comes in Kathopanishad itself. And Kathopanishad is a very old Upanishad. Says, in that state, tam yogam iti manyante sthiram indriya dharanam. When you control all your senses completely, and your mind, buddhish apramattas tadabhavati yogo hi pravapyo. And apramattas, this is not the slightest diversion. And in that state, then what happens? Your senses have calmed down. Your mind has calmed down. Your intellect has calmed down. You become completely free from any kind of illusions, from any kind of delusion. And that is the state of yoga. It is known as yoga. And yoga hi pravapyo says, yoga is that state which creates everything and that dissolves everything. Prabhava appear, to create, to dissolve. And, you know, the very interesting thing that Acharya Shankar here mentions, first time when I read it, I found it very interesting. It says, what people call yoga is actually vyoga. If you read Patanjali's Yoga Sutra, it says, chitta vritti nirodh, cessation of all mental waves. Okay. And then he goes on to explain that once there is a cessation of all mental waves, this stage is known as samadhi. And when a person is not in that state of samadhi, in that higher state, you are what your mental waves are. You are what your mental waves are. Vritti sarupyam itaratra. Normally, you are what your vrittis are, your mental waves are. To give a very simple example, if I am looking at you, my senses are attached with you. My ears, my eyes, these are all attached to you. Smell. And that's how I know you. But when I go in state of meditation, when I go in state of samadhi, I'm actually withdrawing. And yet it is described as yoga. Yoga technically means to join. Technically yoga means to join. But in the actual highest state of yoga, there is a disjointment. This is a very interesting thing. That's yoga. Actually it's mind. Basically what it means to say is that it's mind which is the cause of the world and it is cause of self-realization. So normally we think of yoga, that state where you attain samadhi. But if you are very true, if you are talking literally, then that state is actually vyoga, because you are withdrawing yourself from everything else. And yoga is when you attach yourself to the world. But because yoga has now become a technical term, where yoga means the state where your mind stops. And Sri Ramakrishna himself says that yoga is that process by which you attach yourself to God. So because there is attachment with God, it is taken in that sense. But if you go strictly by the definition that Patanjali has given, then that yoga is actually vyoga. So yoga hi pravapyo, this yoga. There's a rise and fall of it. There are different interpretations. One is, it's the mind which is the root cause of this creation and this dissolution. It also means that the state of yoga, where you are identified with self, sometimes it is powerfully there, sometimes it weakens a bit. So one needs to practice the control of senses pretty seriously. One should not be light-hearted about it, because it's not that you have attained once, you have practiced once, and you become master of it. No, it doesn't. You need to be steady about it. And this idea is repeated again in verse number 12. Naiva vachana mansa praptum shakyo na chakshusa astiti bruvato anyatra katham tat upalabhyate. Sis, one cannot know this self through mind, through speech, through reading, through talking, through listening. There's just no way that you can know it through senses. There's no way that you can know it through studying or reading. Because it's very subtle. And that's why people who don't have faith in this thing, those who are really not striving for it, they can never know Atman. The background is, we will not go in much detail, some of the ideas we have discussed earlier. See what happens. The problem that this universe has come out of nothing has been, it's a very old idea. If you look at the Christian traditions where it says that God created the universe, so they never had this issue. For a Christian, God created the universe. Similarly for the Muslims, God created the universe. Allah created the universe. But Hindus allow diversity. Hindus are a highly pluralistic society, even in matters of religion, spirituality and thoughts. Best example is Buddhist monks. Now if you think of Lord Buddha, when he started preaching, initially people thought that, well, he is just any of the sages. And he was talking about shunya, everything merging in void, and everything coming out of void. That might be spiritual void, because there are arguments about it, what exactly Lord meant by that. But when you look at physics, today's physics, they are only talking about void, at least today. Maybe tomorrow they might change. So when they are talking about Big Bang and all those things, they are talking about everything coming out of nothing. Now it's such a simple thing that it's not possible that something can come out of nothing. Through equations you can make it show. Or actually physics says that we don't know how exactly it happened, and it's known as singularity, where those things, the equations collapse, the idea collapses. But somewhere this idea remains. Now, if you look at a common man, we might say that everything has come out of God. But do we really believe that we have come from God? Or for that matter, do Christians really believe that they have come from God? No, they don't. It's very difficult. It's very difficult to hold on to the idea that I have come from God. It's very difficult to hold on to the idea that my existence is in God. When it comes to taking oath, when it comes to taking vows, we take in the name of God. Even if you look at this American society, at least some years, some decades ago, they would, when they went to court, often they would take the oath in the name of God. Even in their parliament, they take oath in the name of God. But do they really believe in God? No, it's not possible. Somehow you believe that your existence just came. You just came out of nothing. More importantly, as far as Christians are concerned, it's more dangerous, because God created once. After that, what? God created the world. Now, He has not been creating you and me like that. You can stretch your imagination, you can stretch the ideas and say that, well, God created you. But did God really create you? No, they didn't. Because God created once. And creation is not a perpetual process according to the Bible. It was a one-time affair. And after that, it has been continuing. So you are a born sinner, because Adam and Eve, they were sinners. So somewhere you feel, apart from all these theological discussions, somewhere you feel that in the heart of hearts, you came from nothingness, you will merge into nothingness. And that's why you keep on doing things that you shouldn't be doing. You're sleeping at night without proper protection, and you know that two snakes have entered. Will you be able to sleep after that? Two venomous snakes have entered? No, you cannot. If you are entering a property and you find beware of dogs, how careful you will be while entering. Now, if you really believe that God created you and you will go to God and God is looking after you, will you be behaving the way we are behaving? No, you won't. We are afraid of dog. We are never afraid of God. So all these things are mere talk. Somewhere you, some in the heart of hearts, you believe that you came out of nothing, zero, and you will merge into zero. But because traditions talk about God, and you have grown up in such traditions where you find the word God mentioned everywhere. So, in the name of taking vow, when there is marriage and when you have to go to court, etc., you just say God. Here the Upanishads say that people who know that Atman exists, astiti, one who knows, who is firm about it, only they can know this. Those who don't even have faith, there is no question of their knowing it. Because this knowledge cannot be acquired by reading books, nor by listening, nor by giving long lectures. There's just no way. So first you have to have very deep conviction. And that conviction has to come from a master. And then slowly you build up on that conviction. And that's how you can reach self-knowledge. And from there, it says that one has to know that it exists. So verse number 13 talks about two states of knowledge. Astityev uplabdhabhya tattvabhavena chobhayo astityev uplabdhasya tattvabhava prasidati. Atman has to be realized theoretically and also in reality. Tattva is a word where it means in actuality. Now what happens? Just now we were discussing how we really don't have much faith in the existence of God. Now Kathopanishad doesn't talk about God, and the Upanishads, they are not into this God thing, they are into Atman. They believe more about Atman. Now, supposing, let's say that you want to go for God realization, let's say. And let's focus on one work, that is Gospel of Sri Ramakrishna. Because every scripture ultimately talks in the same way. Now, if you look at Gospel of Sri Ramakrishna and you want to go for God realization, how do you go for it? First, you need to have a very clear intellectual understanding. Now, one of the things that you learn in Ramakrishna tradition is the whole creation has come from Sri Ramakrishna, from God. But most importantly, it says that Brahman and Shakti, they are one and the same. That's the most important thing that is taught in Ramakrishna tradition, which means the pure consciousness, that the Atman and its effect in the form of energy, they are actually one and the same. And then there are other things. If you look at the idea of God in different religions, you find that every religion will be talking about God is there and creation has come out of God and creation dissolves in God. So some idea is formed. Once some idea is formed and you learn that from a competent teacher that God exists and these are the characteristics of God. And from there you hold on to some ideas and then you proceed. Now Hindus have mastered this. If you look at the huge number of scriptures of the Hindus, including Mahabharata and Ramayana, particularly Tulsidas' Ramayana, what it does is, it just goes on narrating the various things that are the effects of God's work. Sometimes it is known as, the term is divine sport, Leela. It's not only about creation, dissolution. Hindus also talk about avatar, where God incarnates as human beings or incarnates as different creatures. And he is doing lots of things. Then what you do is, you just focus on that thought. For example, Sri Krishna is there. Now, Sri Krishna has done lots of things. If you focus only on one thing, that Lord Krishna, he is God, and when he came on this earth, he played lots of pranks. It is enough to take you to God realization. And then if you focus on just how he sported with the gopis, it's enough to take you to God realization. If you just focus on how he led Arjuna during the Mahabharata war, it is enough to take you to God realization. How? He says, astitev uplabdhavya. First is, you need to have a very intellectual understanding about how everything that God does is divine. Whether you are seeing him as incarnation of God or you are seeing him as God the Supreme, first you have to understand everything that he has done is divine. And from there you start focusing more and more till you have God realization. Now Kathopanishad doesn't talk about God. Kathopanishad talks about Atman. It's not going to talk about creation by Atman, things like that. It simply says that the discussion that has been going on, once Nachiketa asked and Yamaraja has been explaining, that this body is moved by the power of the senses, and the senses themselves are moved by the power of mind. Mind is controlled and regulated by the intellect, and mind and intellect, both of these get their sustenance and power from Atman. If you are convinced about it, Sri Ramakrishna had thousands and thousands of spiritual experiences, and they are well recorded. He says that it is clearly seen that there is pure consciousness, there is only Atman. And these bodies, persons, they're just like pillowcases. Like if you look at Ganga and its waves, and you throw certain things, you find that certain things are moving up and down. So he's seeing human beings just as pillowcases. Like inside the pillow, inside every pillow, there is cotton. Just like that, inside everybody, there is only pure Atman. And then he says, his disciple, Swami Adbhutananda, in those days he was known as Latu. Latu was sitting with his cheeks on his palm, fist. Says, I saw his Lord himself sitting like that. Actually, it's a fact that Atman alone exists and everything else is superimposed on it. Now, once you understand it theoretically and you're convinced about it, you're great. You're already great. And after that, just one step remains, and that is actually seeing it that way. I mean, let's see the implication of it. Supposing I see that you are all Atman and just superimposition. The mind has been superimposed on it. How? You might have seen one those hurricane lanterns. There is that flame and there is some kind of glass. There is glass covering. And outside that glass covering, suppose you cover something more and more. You're seeing the light and then you realize that it's not the glass that's lighting up. It's the flame inside that is lighting up the glass. Or whenever there is some kind of translucent material, you realize that this is not giving light, but there is some other source that is giving light. If you are convinced, then you realize that you are convinced of the majesty of Atman. If you have reached that state, and if all your acts are in accordance with that idea, you are a great person already. If somebody who believes in God and believes that everything that is happening is because of God, God alone is the ruler, and it's God's will that pervades. If you are really convinced, truly convinced, that God alone does everything, you have reached the highest that mind can take you. Beyond that, that's beyond you. Then only God can reveal himself. Now that's beyond your effort. So if you can reach that level, even if you are convinced that God exists, just this conviction, you have reached the highest. But it says that you should also know it as the actuality. When you actually see it, after that what happens? It doesn't go away. Earlier it was mentioned how yoga hi pravapyo. Yoga rises and falls. So if you reach that conviction, there is a possibility that you may come down. Sometimes you may have doubts. Once you have seen it, after that, there is no doubt. Once you put your finger in fire, there never is any slightest doubt that fire burns. You may have, till you know that fire burns, you have a theoretical understanding. Once you have seen the power of fire, you never have the slightest doubt. Once you have known Atman, doubt never crosses your mind regarding the power, majesty and supremacy of Atman. So he says, and once, it says that once your conviction is there fully, in the self-knowledge, it reveals itself unto you. If you look at the life of Sri Ramakrishna, he didn't have scriptural knowledge. He had not even done sadhana. He just wanted to know if there is God. And he was passionate about it. And he became so passionate about it, he went so deep into it, he was so thoroughly convinced about it, nothing else remained for him. And finally, Mother Kali revealed herself to him. Actually, this happens with everybody. Even if you have done no proper sadhana, even if you have not studied scriptures, but you are deep into it, and your convictions are deep, every act of yours is in accordance with that truth, one day it reveals. It's something like, you know, if you truly love someone and you're devoted towards that person and totally devoted, committed, and your mind never wavers from that person, a day comes when that person changes his or her attitude and says, okay, fine, I accept you. There are many stories of where a king has accepted somebody and or somebody who was loved was accepted. No, things are that. You say that you alone exist for me. So even the person who is derisive of you, doesn't want to accept you, will accept you today or tomorrow. That means you only have a right to pray. The acceptance comes from the other side. That's what Upanishad says, that you be established fully. The acceptance has to come from the other side. And actually it will come. It's not that, oh, well, you never know whether or not it will come or not. See, it may take some time, but it has to come. If you are not ready, it is never going to come. It says, astityev uplabdhasya tattva bhava prasidati. Once you are fixed in that knowledge, theoretically, self-knowledge reveals itself to you. And what happens then? Yada sarve pramuchyante kama esse hrdi sthita atha martyor mrito bhavati atra brahma samashnute. It says, all the desires from your heart, when they are gone, absolutely gone, then what is mortal becomes immortal. And you become one with Brahman even while living in this body. See, in other religions, you can go to heaven, you can know God only after you are dead. But Vedanta says that you can attain the highest even while living. And this idea is repeated in our various scriptures. It says, atra brahma samashnute. Here itself you realize God. Here itself you become one with Brahman. And you go beyond this cycle of birth and death. You go beyond, absolutely beyond, the possibility of a rebirth. And how does it go away? All your desires? Yatha sarve prabidhyante hridayasyeha granthaya at martyor mrito bhavati etavat tyanushasanam. Now, Yamaraj has been teaching Nachiketa, and he has been teaching, and suddenly he says that, he takes a back seat and says, look, this has been the traditional wisdom. Etavati anushasanam. Anushasan means teaching, anushasan means instructions. What? that all the knots of your heart, when they are cut asunder, and how many knots we have in the heart? Infinite. You know, this beautifully, this story of Alexander and Gordian's knot says anybody who opens this Gordian knot will rule Asia. Gordian knot, it was knot. Alexander was so desirous to rule Asia. He just went and struck it with his sword. And that knot came undone. The idea is who can remove this knot? Instead of opening, he just cut it. At times I wonder where from this story came. Because it is straight from the Upanishads. You become the ruler of yourself and consequently the ruler of the universe if all the knots of your hearts are untied, if all the knots are cut asunder. And that's when the immortal becomes mortal. Your desires have to go away. And the knots, like all the confusion that we have, all the fear that we have, all the emotions that we have, all the attractions, attachments that we have, and all the repulsions that we have, these are all knots. They have kept us totally tied down. Apparently it seems that we are emotionally tied down, but actually all those knots are within our heart, within our mind. They need to be cut asunder. When you cut those knots asunder, and that's when the superflow of knowledge and the superflow of bliss and the superflow of power is there within you. And then you realize that you are not mortal, you are immortal. You are not weak, you are super powerful. So, he says how? Shatam chaika chardasya nadya tasha murdhanam abhinishriteka tayor dvamayan namritattva metti vishwanganya utkramane bhavanti. It gives an example that there is durva grass. You might have seen one of those small grass plants. And if you try to take the innermost thing out, you need to be very careful. During the pujas, all the rituals that Hindus worship, grass plays a very important role. And for that, what they do is, the grass is sometimes cut or just plucked. And from there, you pluck the stem out. And you have to be very focused about it, very soft about it. If you are not, the whole thing will be lost. Something needs to be taken out. You have to be very careful about it. Says this Atman, which is inside this heart, and it is well surrounded by hundreds and thousands of knots, it needs to be taken out. And physically it means that inside the body, there are lots of nerves and nerve currents. And there is one which is here on the crown of head. So the Atman at the time of death has to move through that. So first one was, you become immortal while living. And second one is, at the time of death, if your soul, it goes out from the crown of head. Now, that is possible only for people who are deeply religious. They can control the movement of everything within their body. So he says that at the time of death, the subtle body that is inside you, if it comes out through the crown of head, normally it comes out from different openings of the body, and then you are not born again. This is a very, very old concept with the Hindus. There are two ways to gain immortality. First one is when you get self-knowledge, and second is if you have lived a deep religious life, and then you give up your body accordingly, and it comes out through the crown of your head. Now, whatever has been told, starting verse number 1 till now, this is being summed up in one single verse. Angusta matra purusho antaratma sadajananam mridaya sangnivishta tang shvat sharirat parbriyen munjad vishikam dheryen tang vidyat shukram amritam tang vidyat shukram amritamiti. So, here it was about taking this Atman out from the wave of nerves. And that idea is repeated, it's just like that grass, the stalk of grass being taken out. It says, the Atman, it resides within you, just like thumb of light. Earlier also we had mentioned that. Actually, when you meditate, and when you go deep into meditation, you literally see it. You literally see it. And one needs to take it out very carefully out of one's body. Because if you don't, then it gets stuck up with other things and then you will be born again. The question originally by Nachiketa was, whether or not Atman exists. Yamaraj is telling, it does exist. And there are two ways to know it. One is through self-knowledge. And second is at the time of death. So verse number 16 and 17, they need to be understood conjointly. At the time of death, one needs to bring out the self that lies within everybody very patiently. And that's how you become immortal. Similarly, if you can know this self, the way it is, infinite, eternal, then also you become immortal. So, that's the way out. Yamaraj, the Lord of Death, he sums up the entire teaching and says, the Upanishad is over. Verse number 18, it is known as Granth Stuti. In praise of the scripture, Mrityu Proktam Nachiketod Labdhva Vidyametam Yog Vidhim Chakrishnam Brahma Prapto Virjo Abhut Vimrityu Anyopyayam Yo Vidadhyatma Meva. So this Lord of Death, he preached Nachiketa this knowledge. And Nachiketa, by gaining this knowledge, he became completely free from all kinds of impurity. He was beyond dharma and adharma. He was beyond virtue and vice. He became one with the self and he became immortal. Death was not going to touch him ever again. He says, anyone who pursues this adhyatma vidya, anyone who goes for it, he will also have the same result. And it says, Om Sahana Bhavatu Sahano Bhunaktu Sahaviryam Karvavahe Tejasvinavadhi Tamastu Mavid Vishavahe. Om Shanti Shanti Shanti. So with this Kathopanishad ends. The to sum up the whole thing, although we have been summing it up for quite some time now, Nachiketa, the young boy, was gifted by his father to Lord of Death. And because it was not time for Nachiketa to die, and because Nachiketa's father had given him away out of sheer anger, so Lord forgave him and gave three boons. That's the story. The first boon, Nachiketa wanted worldly good, in the sense that when he returned, his father should have accepted him. Number two, he wanted to have the knowledge of heaven, how to reach the highest heaven. And the third, he wanted to know the secret of immortality. And then Yamaraj, he goes on talking about the nature of Atman, which is the reality, ever existence within everyone. And the Lord of Death, he praised this thing variously and summed up by saying that it needs to be taken out from the body very patiently, very delicately. And if you can know the eternal nature of Atman and the whole thing in its infinite majesty, it appears before you because you have practiced like that, then even while in this body, you become one with the infinite. And because you have become one with the infinite, no sorrow can touch you, no death can ever touch you. So how to be immortal? How to go beyond death? That was the subject matter of this Upanishad, and it beautifully explained the idea. With this, we end this.